morning, Lord, is that we might always remember that, that our help cometh from thee, O Lord. And our time of need and our times of distress, that we can always look heavenward and find help in our times of trouble. What a comfort that is. What a joy to know that I can call God and find the help that I need. For that reason alone, Lord, I lift my hands. I open my mouth. I stomp my feet. I give you the praise. And I thank you for being a present help in times of trouble, times of turmoil, times of tribulation. I have help. Regardless of what others do or say, regardless of what others may not do or may not say, I know for a surety in whom I have believed, and that he is able, willing, and ready to rescue all of those that call upon his name. So God, rescue us from the world in which we live. Give us time, give us covering until the great day of your return. Hallelujah, when we will look, when we will listen and hear the trumpet of Zion ringing from heaven, letting us know that Christ has returned. So be with us now, even as we study your word, giving us insights and understanding into things that have passed, things that are current, and of the things that are yet to come. It is your will that we not be ignorant concerning the last days. So bless our time together, and we'll be careful to give your name the praise. And all of God's people say amen. 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 Amen again. Amen. Come on, give God your best hand clap of praise. Oh Lord, we bless your name. Oh Lord, our Lord, how excellent. Excellent. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. Amen. And we bless his name forever. While I got you standing, let me work those heels a little bit longer. Turn with us to the New Testament book of Acts, the 8th chapter. There you will find our text for this morning. I'm going to ask that you turn there with us. The book of Acts, the 8th chapter. We're going to look at the story of the Ethiopian eunuch. And that's found in verses 26 through 40. So if you have that, everybody's looking in like they're in good shape. Now we're also going to add to the witness out of Isaiah, the 53rd chapter. So we're going to, our primary story today is going to be the Ethiopian eunuch, and that's in Acts 8, 26 through 40. So I'm going to ask that you would turn there. That's what we're going to be working from this morning. And then we also want to look at Isaiah, the 53rd chapter, because in this story of the Ethiopian eunuch, there is a reference made to Isaiah 53. Amen? Amen. And so I just want to cover that, so as we're going through the story, I don't have to explain that right in the middle of the story. Because if I have to do that, that's two sermons in one day. How many people want one sermon or two? You don't know how to answer. They're like, well, Pastor, if you want the real answer, a half a sermon would actually work. Well, look, the game is on at one preacher. We got to. No. So I'm working with you. Okay, everybody got on their Eagles green. Y'all ain't fooling around. I got it. I'm with it. But so let's look at our primary text, Acts 8:26. And then what we're going to do when we go to Isaiah, You'll be seated. I won't hold you up for Isaiah, but we'll read through Isaiah just so we can understand what that passage of scripture is about. Amen?
Amen.
Here we go. Acts 26. Now an angel of the Lord spoke to Philip, saying, "Arise and go toward the south along the road which goes down from Jerusalem to Gaza. This is desert or a deserted place." So Philip, being obedient, he arose and went. And behold, a man of Ethiopia, a eunuch of great authority under Candace, the queen of the Ethiopians, who had charge of all of her treasury and had come to Jerusalem to worship, was returning. And sitting in his chariot, he was reading Isaiah the prophet. Then the Spirit said to Philip, "Go near and overtake his chariot." So Philip ran to him and heard him reading the prophet Isaiah and said, "Do you understand what you are reading?" And he said, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he asked Philip to come up and sit with him. Now the place in the scripture which he read was this. And this is Isaiah 53 verses 7 and 8. "He was led as a sheep to the slaughter, and as a lamb before his shearer is silent, so he opened not his mouth. In his humiliation, his justice was taken away. And who will declare his generation? For his life is taken from the earth." So the eunuch said unto Philip, "I ask of you, of whom does the prophet say this? Is he talking about himself or another man?" Then Philip opened his mouth and, beginning at that scripture, preached Jesus Christ to him. Now, as they went down the road, they came to some water, and the eunuch said, "Look, here is water. What hinders me from being baptized?" Then Philip said, "If you believe with all your heart, you may." And he answered and said, "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." So he commanded his chariot to stand still. Both Philip and the eunuch went down into the water, and he was baptized. Now, when they came up out of the water, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip away, so that the eunuch saw him no more. And he went on his way rejoicing. But Philip was found at Azotus. And passing through, he preached in all the cities until he came to Caesarea. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I'm going to ask you to turn to Isaiah 53. And we're just going to, like I said, I just want to look at that at the beginning, because I think it'll aid our understanding of this particular passage. And if you're there at chapter 53, just go back a couple verses to Isaiah 52:13. Isaiah 52:13, and we'll start there. It says, "Behold, my servant shall deal prudently. He shall be exalted and extolled and be very high. Just as many were astonished at you, so his visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. So shall he sprinkle many nations, kings shall shut their mouths at him, for what had not been told them they shall hear, and what they had not heard they shall consider." Isaiah 53:1, "Who has believed our report? and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant and as a root out of dry ground. He has no form or comeliness, and when we see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we did not esteem him. Surely he has borne our griefs, has carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God himself, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgression. He was bruised for our iniquities, and the chastisement for our peace was put upon him. And by his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid upon him the iniquity of us all.
Amen.
He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shearers is silent. And he opened not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who will declare his generation? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. And they made his grave with the wicked, but with the rich at his death. Because he had done no violence, nor was any deceit found in his mouth.
Amen.
Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief. When you make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed. He shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the labor of his soul and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant shall justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressor, and he bore the sins of many and made intercession for the transgressor.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Praise God.
In the book of Isaiah, there are four servant songs. And each of these describe the service, the suffering, and exaltation of the servant Lord, known as the Messiah. All four songs or poems show the Messiah to be God's meek and gentle servant. He is a royal figure representing Israel in its ideal form. He is the high priest atoning for the sins of the world. Isaiah predicts that this servant of the Lord would deliver the world from the prison and grips of sin.
Yeah.
In the royal terminology of the ancient Near East, a servant was a trusted envoy, a confidential representative, and one who was carefully chosen. These servant songs, these four servant songs, can be found in Isaiah, the 42nd chapter, verses 1 through 9. The second is found in Isaiah 50, verses 4 through 11. That's the third one. The second one is in Isaiah 49, verses 1 through 13. That's the second. Isaiah 50 is the third. And what we have read this morning in your hearing, Isaiah, the 52nd chapter, starting at 13 through and including all of chapter 53, is the fourth of these servant songs. The first of the four servant songs introduces us to the servant Lord. The second of the four servant songs speaks of the Messiah's work in the world and his success, meaning he accomplished what he came to do. The servant statement that is made in the second song, that before I was born, the Lord called me, sounds very similar to what we find written in the prophet Jeremiah. The reference in Isaiah 49:2 to the mouth of the servant Lord being like a sharpened sword is a prophetic image that shows up numerous times in the New Testament. In the third servant song, there is a contrast between Israel's sin and that of the servant's faithful obedience, causing us to realize that in God's plan, he wanted Israel to be his example in the world of who God was. But through Israel's faults and failures and their own rebellion, they failed to accomplish God's plan for them.
Amen.
But yet God had another way, and in another way, the same purpose, but he sends a new servant to come, one who would be faithful and true. And you find that in the third servant song. Then in this fourth and final servant song, which we have read, it describes the suffering and triumph of the servant Lord. It is one of the most detailed passages in the Old Testament concerning both the death and resurrection of the Messiah. All of Isaiah 53 is a poignant and prophetic picture of the gospel itself. Jesus was despised and rejected by men. He was stricken by God, his own Father, and pierced for our righteousness. And by his suffering, Jesus received the punishment that, in fact, we and Israel deserved. And he became for us the ultimate and perfect sacrifice. And although his son was sinless, God laid on him our sin, and we became God's righteousness in and by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Jesus was silent in front of his accusers. Jesus was crucified between two thieves, yet buried in a rich man's tomb. In the suffering servant's humiliation and final exaltation, he reconciles humanity back to God.
Praise God. Amen.
Now, I'm sharing all of this because what I want you to understand, and hopefully you'll see as we go through this story, this is what the eunuch was reading.
Amen.
Okay? What Luke points to, and when he says he found this passage in scripture, which is Isaiah 53:7-8, that was what Philip heard as he got close, right? But the reality is, or was, that the eunuch was reading what? The whole story. So the eunuch would have read the first servant song. Then he would have gone on, he would have read the what? The second servant song. So on to the third, and it was during the fourth servant song that Philip approached his chariot. Are you with me? Now hopefully as we go through this, you'll see why that's important. But I wanted to point that out, that he wasn't just reading chapter 53, verses 7 and 8. And I'm saying that because I hope you take time in your own biblical reading, that when, even though you may be pointed to a particular verse or a particular group of verses, read the whole chapter. Do you follow what I'm saying? It'll help you get the gist of the whole story and a fuller meaning to what's being said. Amen?
Amen.
Good. So now let's get into it. In 1979, a song was released called Ain't No Stopping Us Now. We're on the moon. Everybody remember that now? Gotta be old enough. Well, you can remember that. So that was, and it was a disco song performed by the R&B duo McFadden and Whitehead. Released as the lead single from their debut album, the song spent a week at number one on the R&B singles chart. It also proved to be a successful crossover hit, peaking at number 13 on the Billboard Hot 100. It also reached number 5 over across the sea in the United Kingdom. The single also made it to number 10 on the disco charts, and it eventually went double platinum, selling over 2 million copies. And that's when people bought actual records. That's not downloads. Ain't No Stopping Us Now is about succeeding despite having faced previous setbacks and disadvantages. There is a line in the song that says so many things that held us down. But they go on to say, ain't nothing stopping us now. It was widely interpreted to be about the experience of the African community in the United States. And after attaining great popularity, it became referred to in some circles as the new black national anthem. Some people actually called it that during that time. But we know the black national anthem is Lift Every Voice. Amen? Which we still don't know all the words to. Shame on all of you. Shame, 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 shame. And while we may sing the song or even agree with its meaning or words of inspiration, we very often we do allow things, people, and sometimes circumstances to hold us back and to actually keep us from doing the very thing that we know needs to be done. So the question this morning to me and to you and to all of us is, what's holding you back? What's holding you back? Not merely from getting done what's on your to-do list or what you got to get done before school, before Christmas, before the new year. But the reality is, what is holding you back from reaching, connecting, and coming into relationship with God Himself? Because if we look at that list, I would dare to suggest that it is even longer than our own personal to-do list. For many of us, we allow any number of things to stand in the way and to hold us back or prevent us from having, developing a relationship with God through His Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. But if you really want to know Him, while we may let things stand in our way, He, God, will allow nothing to stand in His way of reaching you. Amen. And if you don't believe me, ask the Ethiopian. Are you with me? So just look at your neighbor and say, hey, what's holding you back? Now the story, our primary text is in the book of Acts on the second half of chapter 8. And it is, as I said, the story of the Ethiopian. This man comes from his country and he's coming to Jerusalem to worship. But the thing that is interesting, oftentimes when we study our Bible, when you hear Jerusalem, you often hear of what's happening with and to the people either as they go up to Jerusalem, or more often than not, you hear about what's happening while they are in Jerusalem. But the interesting thing about this story, it picks up with him going home. Doesn't tell us what happened while he was on his way up. Gives us no indication of what occurred while he was there in Jerusalem. It just picks up in verse 28, and it says, look, and he had come to Jerusalem to worship and now was returning. And I think I would do you a disservice and ourselves a disservice if we didn't first at least explore why Luke tells us about the picks up the story with the Ethiopian coming home. So let me offer to you what may or may not have happened. Amen. So the question is, what would cause an Ethiopian to go to Jerusalem? The country of Ethiopia is actually located south of Egypt, and it is over 1,600 miles away. Touch your neighbor and say, that's not around the corner. Wow. You follow that? That's not around the corner. So what causes this Ethiopian to venture into Jerusalem? And the term that was used for him and others like him is that he was a God-fearer. That's what he was. And that was the term given to those in this first century, of those who were not Jewish but yet believed in the Jewish God. God fear is used of those who attach themselves in varying degrees to the religion of Judaism. And they did it without becoming complete converts, meaning they didn't have circumcision, they didn't follow all of the rules and regulations of the Jewish law, but yet the Ethiopian, like many in his time, was drawn to the moral beauty and the monotheism of the Jewish religion. Despite his own religious background, which based on where he was from in the world was probably polytheism, he was still drawn to the God of the Jews. Polytheism means to have multiple gods or deities. In short, it means that these Gentiles, his people, Ethiopians, and many others at that time, they had multiple gods. Amen. They had multiple gods, meaning they had a god for everything they needed or wanted. If there wasn't a God, the priest would make them a God. Do you follow what I'm saying? And that's not too strange to us, because while they had multiple gods then, many people today, we have multiple gods, but it's not gods as you would think of in this text. They were gods in that today we have multiple pills for everything. Pills to get up. Pills to get down. Pills to relax you. Pills to get you exotic, get you excited, never realizing that these prescriptions, this medicine, is a form of spiritual worship. Spiritual worship in that they cause us not to be sane in our mind. Why? Because the medicine induces a feeling or a belief. A lot of times the medicine don't even work. But because you are so convinced that it does, you convince yourself it works. Am I right about it? But the reality is, this guy was being drawn to God by something more than what his polytheistic religion could offer. John 6:44 says it like this: no man can come to God except the Father which has sent me draw him. Meaning that no one can access God or be drawn to God unless God himself places something in them toward him. Amen. And that is what is happening to this Ethiopian eunuch. And so now he responds to God's calling and makes an important decision. He says, I'm going to Jerusalem to worship and offer sacrifice. That's what he said. This God that I'm drawn to, this singular God, unlike what I'm familiar with, where there's a God or a pill for everything, this one God stands up and above. He stands as the singular source of hope and restoration and life fulfillment. And that's exactly what this Ethiopian was looking for. So he makes a decision. I'm going. up to Jerusalem. And so he gets himself together, and now he begins to trek off. But this was no small decision. Because for him to make this choice, it cost him a lot of money. Because being an Ethiopian dignitary, that means he traveled with a caravan. Are you with me on that? He traveled with an entourage, so that cost money. There was the sacrifice of time. Traveling 1,600 miles in biblical times means it was a trip of several weeks one way. One way. This guy would spend half a quarter of the calendar year just going to and returning from Jerusalem. Touch your neighbor and say, this is not a small choice for him. And not only that, it would also cost him something against his reputation. Because his employer, the queen, I'm sure had to ask him, man, why are you going to Jerusalem to worship when you have all of these gods here in Ethiopia? Come on, man. You are the treasurer for our country. You are the guy putting the money behind these religions. Why in the world would you pack up your family, your belongings, and make such a long and dangerous trip? Do you not believe in our gods? Should you not be the treasurer over our money? But in spite of the hit to his reputation, this guy made the decision that, guess what? I'm still going. Touch your neighbor and said, I'm still going. So look, so let's work this. So now he's going. He's going up to Jerusalem. Luke doesn't say what happens on his way up. He gets to Jerusalem, and we don't have any information, but might I offer this? Something out of antiquity that may help us. That when he gets there, he's going to worship. He's going to sacrifice. He's brought an offering. He's brought whatever animal is required. He's brought his money, being a man of wealth. He's brought all of that to worship and to honor this God of the Jews. Might I offer this, that he finds when he gets there, first, he finds out that being an Ethiopian is against him. Because when he gets to Jerusalem, he begins to realize that people, the Jews, refer to him as a Gentile. And being a Gentile, although he had come to the temple, he was only allowed to enter the outer temple. It is what historians call the court of the Gentiles, and it was here that the Gentiles and all of those who were non-Jews, they were permitted to enter but could not go any further. You got to understand, in order for him to give his offering, he would have to go to the next court, which is the court of the women. That's where they had the offering baskets. And if he wanted to offer and sacrifice, he would have to get all the way to the inner court where the priests were in order to give his offering, in order to be sacrificed. Here he comes, prepared to go all the way, and he stopped at first base. His ethnicity hindered him from worshiping God. Can anyone here relate to your ethnicity working against you? I figured I'd get at least a few amens on that. Second, look at this. Second, not only was he an Ethiopian and that was against him, but now he realized that his current state, meaning he was a eunuch, was also against him. Because in the Jewish law, Deuteronomy 23:1, it states that anyone who is emasculated by crushing or mutilation shall not enter the assembly of God. You read the story, he not only was from Ethiopia, he was a eunuch, meaning he had been emasculated, because the thinking in those times and in that area, that those men who had been emasculated would serve better in the royal palace. So now he gets to the temple. He's coming to Jerusalem to worship. He's bringing his offering. He's ready to worship. But he gets there and he sees a sign that says Gentiles can go no further. The only word that he hears is from Deuteronomy saying those that had been emasculated could go no further. And so now he realizes that what others had done to him, not his own choice, he couldn't do anything about being Ethiopian. And he had what was done to him in terms of being emasculated, that was done against him. Probably as a young man, someone thought it was in his best interest and now has mutilated him. And now his mutilation hinders him from worshiping God. Now he's got two strikes against him. But before we count him all the way out, let's not forget that he was rich. Touch your neighbor and said he was rich. Money may not buy everything, but it can get you a few things. It may not get you everything, but it may get you a few things. And so this guy, he was served in the queen's court. So he not only had money, he had access to money. And now that he was being presented from worshiping God, he says, wait a minute, I got something I can do. Because even though you guys won't allow me in, you will accept my money. He said, no, you can't worship, but your American Express card you can put right here. But this guy was so hungry for God, he still made the deal. And we know he made the deal because we find him reading on his way back home from the prophet Isaiah. That suggests to us that while in Jerusalem at the holy city, though prevented from worshiping, he used his money to buy a Bible. Got to understand, the Old Testament was scripture at that time. And not only did he use his money, he used a lot of his money. I found this interesting when reading this. The book of Isaiah, being as long as it is, one of the longest books in the Bible, it is noted by historians that for a scribe to translate, to write, copy the book of Isaiah would take a scribe over 1 year to complete. 1 year, every day, except the Sabbath, writing. Just copy. Looking at the original manuscript, taking out a fresh scroll, and just copying. Now that's hard for us to fathom because we live in a world where we just what? Cut and paste. We got it on our phones. It's up on the internet. But these were times that in order to get a copy, one man had to give up a year of his life to rewrite and copy for you the manuscript that you wanted. So here he is. Let's say, let's put a value on it. So in your own mind, everybody just think of how much you make in a year. Just get it in. All right, let's do this too. Think of how much you would like to make in a year. Let's get that number. There you go. Now we're working. Get that number in your head. Listen, that's how much this guy paid to get a word from the Lord. That's how much he had to pay the scribe a year's worth of salary in order to get a copy of the prophet Isaiah. And again, that's hard for us to understand. Why? Because to get a Bible today, it's easy access. What a wonderful privilege that is, but often a privilege that we abuse or often underuse. Because it's so easy, because they're free in the hotels, and because we can just put an app on our phone, because we can just Google it and find it, we have a tendency in Western world to devalue the Word of God. But not the Ethiopian. Why? Because it cost him so much to get a copy. Are you with me? Tell your neighbor it cost something to get it. So now look, he's got a car. He can't go into the temple. He's denied at the front. He says, well, if I got to go, let it leave. I already brought an offering to give, but since you won't allow me to get to the inner court to give it, let at least let me get a copy of the word of God. So he gets the most he can. He gets the book of Isaiah, and now he is forced to leave. But still hungry for God, even though he's leaving, now he's got to travel several weeks to get back home. He begins reading the word of God. Amen. The word that he's just purchased. He's reading about the God that the people wouldn't let him worship. He's going to read about the God who the chief priest said, because of what was done to you, you can't have access to him. So now I'm in the text. Now I'm in verse 28. And now he's going home. Now he realizes, but as he's going home, he's reading the word of God. But now he runs into another obstacle. He's reading a story and he cannot understand it. That was the reason to go to the temple, because there you had the Levites, there you had the priests, and as Ezra said, they would make sense or give sense or give an understanding to what the word of God meant. But because he was prevented from going into the temple, he had no understanding. And so while he was hungry for God, he was confused about God. Confused not only by what he read, but confused by the people who represented God. I wish I had a real church. Have you ever encountered a religious setting where the people confuse you about God? We hear God is love and God is merciful and God is gracious, but yet when I encounter the people of God, I actually experience something that is quite different. I do not experience the love of God. I've actually been in church when I've been hated by other people. And instead of finding mercy from God, I find church people who are merciless. And instead of finding grace and forgiveness, I encounter people in the temple in Jerusalem who will not forgive me for what I've done. So now I'm not only confused by the people, I'm confused by the word. But guess what? Touch your neighbor and said he kept on reading. I like the Ethiopian. He said, I'm going to keep on reading. Maybe the story will change. So he leaves Jerusalem. He's heading home. He's frustrated, but he's not discouraged. And I know he's not discouraged because what? He keeps on reading. Psalms 42:1 says, as the deer pants for the water brook, so pants my soul for you, O Lord. My soul thirsts for God, the living and true God. While the Ethiopian was hindered from reaching God, God was not hindered from reaching him. Touch your neighbor and said, I'm glad about it. Romans 8:35 says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Who is able to stop God from reaching me? I know what it is to find obstacles in reaching God. Some of them are perpetrated against me. Many more are brought upon myself by my own doing. But what can hinder God from reaching me? Touch your neighbor and says, nothing can stop him. So now Philip enters the story. So you got the Ethiopian going away from Jerusalem. He's going away from God. He's going away from the city of God. He's going away from the people of God. And it would seem like he would go home with failure in his hands. But the Bible said the Ethiopian kept on reading. And while he was reading, God was speaking. And the text said that God tapped Philip on his shoulder. You know Philip, our great revivalist. You know Philip, who preached until the whole city of Samaria turned to Jesus Christ. He was enjoying great fame and notoriety. But this time, when God tapped him on the shoulder, he said, I want you to leave Samaria and I want you to take a desert road down to Gaza. I can imagine Philip saying, you want me to leave the church now? Just when I got it up and going. Just when I got the people coming. What do you mean I got a new assignment? He said, head down to Gaza. And to get there, he had to go through a deserted area. The area was deserted, representing that the Ethiopian had been deserted. Everything had been against him, but in spite of it all, God sent his man to reach the Ethiopian. Touch your neighbor and say, won't God do it? So God calls his preacher, said, I got another assignment for you, and it's not in Samaria. And no, you don't get to go with Peter and John back to Jerusalem. I got a new city. I got a new place. It's not bright lights. It's not big city. It's a deserted town called Gaza. But there, I've got a guy who is hungry for me. He's not of great wealth or notoriety in Jerusalem, but he means the world to me. Romans 10:14 said, how shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in whom they had not heard? How shall they hear without a preacher? And how can the preacher preach unless he be sent? Touch somebody, say, thank God for my preacher. You may not realize it, but your preacher is more important than your accountant. And I know tax time is coming, but your preacher is more important than your attorney. And I know you got a big case now, and you're looking to hit big, but you need a preacher who, when life turns against you, you need a preacher when you face opposition after opposition. You need a preacher who can remind you that God said, I'll let nothing. Thank God for my preacher who gives me the word. Thank God for my preacher who explains it to me. Thank God that I got a preacher. Somebody in the church say, so God's preacher comes alongside the Ethiopian eunuch, and he finds him reading the fourth servant song. And so he says to the eunuch, excuse me, sir, do you understand what you are reading? And the Ethiopian was honest. Unlike most of us, we'll just lie and say, yeah, I got it. How many Sundays after Sunday do I ask my church, if you got it, say I got it? But the Ethiopian, he didn't take the bait from this preacher. He said, I don't understand. I've read the first song. I've read the second poem. I've read the third, and I'm now on the fourth. And I still don't understand. He said, I need somebody to explain this to me. Touch your neighbor and say, I need a little help here. I need help with this word. I believe it's talking to me, but I'm just not sure. Would you mind coming on up and explaining the word to me? So the Bible said, Philip stepped in the chariot, and starting right there, he began to explain to the Ethiopian eunuch what the word of God meant. He explained the first song. He explained the second song. He explained the third and the fourth. And then he started weaving in some of the apostles' doctrine, which he had been taught while in Jerusalem. They wouldn't let the Ethiopian get it, but God sent Philip first out of Jerusalem, then out of Samaria, and he came with a word for the Ethiopian. Somebody somewhere, give the Lord a hand clap of praise. So the Ethiopian went from opposition 1, 2, and 3 to now he had an opportunity. He said, now I couldn't get it when I was in Jerusalem, but right here in my deserted place, it seems that I'm all alone. I'm by myself going to Gaza. But here in a desert place, look at how much God loves me. First, he sends me his word from the prophet Isaiah. Then he sends me his witness, the evangelist called Philip. And now he's made water available to me. Wait a minute, you missed it. That's where the really holy people get up and shout. Yeah. The word he bought with his own money. Philip was assigned to preach, whether in Jerusalem, Samaria, or in Gaza. And I'm sure Philip told him what he had heard the disciples say, which Jesus commanded of them, to go make disciples. And when you have, he said, baptize them in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Ghost. I know Philip preached it, because the eunuch said, look over yonder, I see some water. I'm in a desert place, but God has provided water for me. Somebody thank God for the living water. So now he's got his chance. He said, I traveled all this way, and I don't want to go home empty. I was denied in Jerusalem. I was denied at the temple, and even my own learning was against me. But God has graciously provided an opportunity for me. The word of God says, the day you hear my voice, harden not your heart. The Enoch may not have a lot of Bible, but he knew this would be his only chance. He may never see Philip again. He may never get to Jerusalem again. But God provided some water. So now Philip says, wait a minute. Hallelujah. I've been doing a lot of talking. Glory. Now I've got to test your understanding. Have you just been allowing me to talk so that you can have some company in your chariot? Or do you really understand what I've been saying? He said, if you want to be baptized, he said, there was nothing hindering you. The only hurdle you've got to cross now is tell me, do you believe all that I've said? Do you believe the servant song? Do you believe in Jesus from Nazareth? Do you believe he was crucified? Do you believe he was buried? Do you believe in 3 days that God raised him up? He said, do you believe that he's sitting now on the right hand of God? He said, if you believe, if you believe. He said, come on, let's get in the water. Touch your neighbor and say, let's go down to the water. It's a sign that I believe. And just to confirm it with Philip, the Ethiopian shouted. He said, I believe. He said, I believe in Jesus Christ. And that he healed the Son of God. Somebody say yes. So you got the rest of the story. Down to the water they go. The eunuch, he didn't back down into the water. Last weekend, we took the boys down to the ocean. And we were, before we went to the ocean, the day before we went to the swimming pool in the hotel. And you know how kids do when they come to the pool. They dip and say, oh, it's cold. All up in the hotel room, they were driving me crazy. Come on, Dad, let's go to the pool. Come on, Dad, let's go swimming. We left the room, forgot all of the rafts, forgot all of the floaty devices, and my kids can barely swim. Emphasis on barely. But yet they wanted to go to the pool. And when they got to the pool, all of the other kids were dipping and saying how cold it was. But one of my boys took a running start, got midway in the air, and did a cannonball. And he went head first down. Touch your neighbor, say, I'm going head first. It may be my only chance. My dad may go back to the room. I may not get another chance. So I'm going head first. Head first. I'm saying all that to say, that's how Philip went down. Philip went head first. He said, no, no, no. I'm scared you might go back to Jerusalem. No, no, no. I'm scared you might send some of those crazy church folk down here. He said, no, we go to the water. I'm going head first into the water because I believe that Christ died for me. I believe that he saved me from my sin. I believe that he filled me with his precious Holy Ghost. And I believe. So look, that's the story. Now look, let me finish it. Here's the punchline. All of that is good, but that's not the best part of the story. Because you read in verse 38, the Bible says after Philip baptized him, the Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip up. 1,600 miles. With a day's journey, it meant they were in the middle of nowhere. But as a sign that God had done this, he not only provided the water, then he provided his Spirit. And the Spirit first took Philip out of the company of the eunuch. He said, there goes my preacher. But he had so received the word of God that even absent of his preacher, the Bible said he kept on faith in God. And when I read it over and over, I first thought he was praising God for being baptized, and that he did. But all of the translations helped me to understand that even after God miraculously took Philip, the Ethiopian kept on rejoicing. His preacher was gone. His money was gone. All of his fine clothes were left down by the riverbed. But he kept on. He kept on. Touch your neighbor and said he kept on praising God. And you want to know why? Let me give it to you. You're holding it in your hand. Go to Isaiah 56. Here's the best part. Tell somebody he saved the best for last. And if you don't really dig into this, you'll miss this. Philip, gone. The water, gone. But not his praise. What could sustain a guy to keep rejoicing for several weeks? What could sustain a guy to keep talking about a God he had found when he got back home? The answer to the question is that he kept on reading. Isaiah 56 says this: thus says the Lord, keep justice, do righteousness, for my salvation is about to come. Touch your neighbor and say, keep on reading. And he said, my righteousness is to be revealed. And he said this, he said, blessed is the man who does this, and the son of man who lays hold to what I'm saying, who keeps him from defiling the Sabbath and keeps his hand from doing evil. Touch somebody and tell them, keep on reading. It says, do not let the son of a foreigner who has joined himself to the Lord, don't let him speak. But if he speaks, let him say this: the Lord has utterly separated me from his people. Can you see the eunuch saying, this is me, I am a foreigner, and it seems like God himself has kept me away. But find a neighbor and tell him, keep on reading. He said, no, let the eunuch say, here I am, a dry tree in a deserted place. Look at somebody and say, he's talking to me. I can see the eunuch starting to get happy, but he kept on. I wish y'all would help me, please. Come on, touch somebody and say, he kept on reading. Look what it says. For thus says the Lord to the eunuchs who keep my Sabbath, to the eunuchs who chooses what pleases me, and to the eunuchs who have been denied worship, to the eunuchs who were denied access to every eunuch forbidden from entering the temple. Look what God says: if you do what pleases me and hold to my covenant, even to them, he says, I will. Come on, use your good preaching voice and say, I will. All my preachers, y'all, I thought y'all were going to carry it. We had it. I thought you were just going to take it. He said, I will give in my house. Let me help you. The temple in Jerusalem, that was Herod's house, built with Herod's money, under Herod's authority. It was so much under his control that the Romans built a military compound right on the temple campus. It was under Roman control, even though they allowed the Jews to worship, even though he allowed them to have the Torah. It was Herod's house. But look what God said to the eunuchs. He said, in my house. Y'all didn't even get it. I did all that yelling and screaming. Y'all didn't get it. He's not talking about Herod's house. He's referring to God's very own house. Look at your neighbor and say, in God's house. He said, there, I will give you a place, and not only a place in my house, but I'll give you a name. I'll give you a name that is better than my sons, better than my daughters. He was referring to Israel. He said, you love me more than my own kids. And as a result, I'm going to make it better. God, help me, help me, help me, help me. He said, and I will give them an everlasting name that shall never be cut off. Because the eunuch kept on reading. He found out that God had a better house because he kept on reading. He found out God had a better covenant because he kept on reading. He found out that God had a better way, and all he had to do was believe in Jesus, and he would have access. He would have access. So now I understand why he kept on rejoicing. He kept on rejoicing because he kept on reading. And the more he read, the better the story got. And not only, now you're missing the miracle. This thing is loaded with miracles. Philip de Gaza, the water. All loaded with miracles. Not only is the miracle in the Lord sweeping Philip away, but here's a miracle a lot of people don't see in the scripture because they don't stay there long enough. He kept on reading, and his understanding increased. Watch this. Without his preaching. God had begun to open the eyes of his understanding. So even without Philip, he looked at the word of God and said, God is talking to me. The eunuch said, I refuse to let anything else hold me back. I almost let the queen hold me up. She gave me more work to do. And had I been younger and more foolish and not as hungry for God, guess what? I would have signed up for the overtime. I would have valued money more than the presence of God. I finally get to Jerusalem. And the very people I had come to fellowship with told me they didn't want to fellowship with me. There were signs literally posted on pillars as you went from the outer courts into the inner courts that said, Gentiles forbidden from entering the temple.
Amen.
The sign right there. Read it. Look, when I studied it, guess what? Not only was it a sign, guess what? The sign was written in Latin and Greek. Anybody know the importance of that? They were in languages that everyone could read. It's right there. Here he is. He's come all this way.
Yeah.
He's got all these people. He's brought his money. He's brought his sacrifice. He's brought his... All he wants to do is worship. But he runs into opposition. And of all the word that he did hear that day, the word he heard that said, guys like you can't come in. Of all the stuff that's written in the Bible, that's what he heard.
Hallelujah.
I can't go in because of my background. I can't go in. And it's not even because of something I did. It was something that was done against me. And a lot of people fail to reach God because of what somebody has done to them. But aren't you glad that nothing hinders God? And that if he has called you, if he has called you with an everlasting love, now I understand why Paul said, I'll let nothing separate. And you've got to understand when you read that, it's not Paul's might that he's talking about. He said, the reason that nothing can separate me from the love of God is not me. But because to whoever the arm of the Lord is revealed, God will call him. And nothing can hinder God. Look at it, point by point. Everything that stopped him, God moved out of the way. He went from obstacles to opportunities, and then from there to opulent praise. Now at the church, we're studying the Acts story, the New Testament church, and now this is a picture of how the gospel spreads from Jerusalem to Samaria with Philip, then from Samaria down to Ethiopia, 1,600 miles away. And the apostles didn't take it. But an Ethiopian who had been called by God.
Amen.
All because he made up in his mind, I'll let nothing hold me back.
Amen.
My circumstances, my situation, what I've done, what others have done to me, not anymore. Not any longer. Today I hear the Lord calling me. Watch this. I know it was the Lord calling him, because if it had not been the Lord calling him, guess what he would have done? He would have quit a long time ago. But each obstacle, something kept pulling him back.
Amen.
Kept pulling. He couldn't get there on his own, but God made up the difference.
Amen.
God became his bridge from death into life. So like I told you at the beginning of this sermon, the question of importance is, what's holding you back?
Amen.
What obstacles are on your list? Well, I would if I... Well, you know what, Pat? Not this week, but next week I'll... Day after day, week after week, guess what? It's just more obstacles. But the word of God said, the day you hear my voice. What does that mean, Pat? Do I hear him? No. The day you begin to sense something bigger, deeper, and you can't seem to satisfy it. You got to understand, this guy had tried to satisfy. You got to understand, he was from Ethiopia. He had many gods to choose from. And I don't think it's a stretch to say he didn't try all, if not many of them. But even after all of that, none of them satisfied him.
Right.
They couldn't have. What would cause him to risk so much?
Yes. Praise God.
He couldn't explain it, but God was calling him.
Amen.
Just like he's calling you today.
Amen.
That's the whole purpose of this sermon. To cause you to recognize and understand, to give some meaning to what you feel, what you sense in your belly. It's not more of the same. It's not more of the same people. It's not more of the same stuff. You do that and you find yourself still wanting. Why? Because that's not the answer.
Amen.
Coming up as kids, we used to sing a song. We used to always make the kids sing it on Youth Sunday. It would say, Jesus is the answer for the world today.
Amen.
They said above him, there's no other. Said Jesus is the way.
Amen.
What's holding you back? What's keeping you from believing in and receiving Jesus Christ?
Amen. Amen.
What's keeping you from going further with God?
Glory.
Do you not hear? Do you not sense him calling you?